Hi, this is Helectronics. In this video I will build a TDA2822M stereo amplifier IC based circuit on the breadboard. Before the video starts, be sure to subscribe and press the bell to get notified when a new interesting video is uploaded. The TDA2822M is an 8-pin dual inlay packer stereo amplifier IC, the little brother of the TDA2822, which has 16 pins. It is very common in older radio and cassette players because it is good for battery-powered system. As you can see on the picture, in this video I will test three TDA2822M IC from different manufacturers. First one has an unknown logo, I couldn't identify the manufacturer. The second is made by ST Microelectronics, the last one has HYC written on it without a logo. Let me know in the comments if you know the manufacturers of the first and last IC. The first unknown manufacturer IC will be used in the beginning and later it will be swapped with the other two. This is the pinout of the IC, which will be the guidance to build the circuit on the breadboard. Don't forget that you can check the datasheet in the description anytime you need it. To power up the IC, the 502 amp SMPS power supply will be used. Recently I made a review video of it, you can check it out. A 1000 microfarad decoupling capacitor will be used on the power supply lines. Now that the power supply is done, let's move on to the components around the IC. I will use this figure from the datasheet to make the circuit. The only addition I make is that at the input I place some monolithic capacitors for safety. These capacitors block any incoming DC voltage which can disturb the function of the amplifier. A 3.5mm stereo audio jack will provide a connection to my phone. 10k ohm input biosync resistors are placed, one for each channel. A 100 microfarad capacitor is placed at the inverting input, also for each channel. The input part is finished, let's move on to the output. The datasheet diagram shown on the right is modified. Where there is 1000 microfarad capacitor now, originally it was 470 microfarad. This increased capacitance means wider frequency response or low frequencies. So I place 1000 microfarad capacitors at each output. Next, 0.1 microfarad polypropylene capacitors are placed at each output. These capacitors are used to eliminate high frequency oscillations and noises. The 4.7 ohm resistors are not necessary. The amp works good also without them, so I will use them later. The last parts needed for the output stage are the speakers. Two 8-ohm speakers will be used for testing. To finish the circuit, the grounds must be connected. The signal ground, the power ground and the pin 4. With the black wire I connect the signal ground to the pin 4 of the IC. With the blue wire I connect the signal ground to the power ground. The red wire is used for the supply voltage at pin 2. Looks like everything is set up. I power up the circuit by connecting the red wire to the supply voltage without audio input signal. As the circuit is powered, a pop sound can be heard. This is a good sign, it means that the amplifier is working. Now I connect the phone to test the circuit with music. There is some noise, but the circuit is working. At that moment I was thinking the noise and hum is made by ground loop, so I tried to modify the ground connections. I take the blue wire's one end, which is at the signal ground, and place it to the pin 4 of the IC. Now the signal ground and the power ground is connected at the pin 4. I do another test to see if there is any difference with the modifications. Now I take out the 0.1 microfarad capacitors and place it back with 1.5 ohm resistors in series with them on each channel to see if it makes any difference. This time I hook up also the oscilloscope to one of the speakers. As you can see on the oscilloscope, this circuit had a lot of noise. It has around 300 mV peak to peak, so I decided to make a second attempt and rebuild the circuit. This time I will show you only the differences compared to the first attempt circuit. I had a 470 nanofarad monolithic capacitor parallel to the bigger electrolytic with the intention to decrease high frequency noise. I used the IC made by ST Microelectronics to see if the results will be better. The input stage won't be changed, so I speed up the video. At the first attempt circuit, I made a mistake and placed a high frequency cutoff filter before the output capacitors. This time I place it as it is shown on the datasheet diagram. While searching between the components, I found two 4.7 ohm resistors, so this time the circuit will be more faithful to the diagram from the datasheet. After placing them on the breadboard, I made another sound quality check and also a measurement with the oscilloscope. The sound was distorted because I was exceeding the maximum output power, but the oscilloscope revealed that without music still the IC was making 300 mV peak-to-peak noise. I decided to make another power supply, this time using linear transformer. This 12V 2.5A transformer will be the supply and an LM7809 linear voltage regulator will provide clean 9V for the amplifier IC. A heatsink has to be installed on the regulator IC, otherwise it may get too hot. This is a close-up shot of the voltage regulator IC with the heatsink. Now I do a full wave rectifier circuit to make from the transformer's alternative current direct current. I use a 2A diode bridge and a 3300 µF decoupling capacitor. This is the diagram of the circuit to transform the 12V AC into stable 9V DC. I place back the 1000 µF decoupling capacitor to the supply lines. Before the circuit is powered up, I measure the supply voltages with the multimeter. This is the unregulated DC voltage and this is the regulated voltage. Now it is safe to connect the supply lines. After powering up, the noise is still there, but it is a little bit lower. While I was doing some more tests, I realized that my phone was also making noise. So to solve this issue, I just switched it to flight mode. This resolved partially the issue, but it was still noisy on the oscilloscope. Accidentally, I found that the LED lights, which I use for video making, is generating high frequency noise and turning it off resolves the issue and the amplifier is crystal clean. I've done more measurements about that noise and zooming in with the oscilloscope showed that the noise was a 50 kHz pulse. The high frequency filter should be able to eliminate this high frequency noise, so I tried to use other kind of capacitors. First, I've replaced the 0.1 µF CBB polypropylene capacitor with 0.1 µF monolithic ceramic capacitor, but the result was worse. The next to try was the 0.22 µF CBB polypropylene capacitor. This increase of capacitance did not make any major improvement. It was a little bit cleaner than the 0.1 µF capacitor, but the difference was hardly noticeable. Also, it can lower the upper end of the frequency response. I also made a test to see what happens if the high frequency filter, the 0.1 µF capacitor and the 4.7 ohm resistor is taken out. After placing back the high frequency filter circuit, I measured the output power. The RMS voltage is 1.28V with 9V power supply. With 8 ohm load, this means 0.2W of output power. The frequency response is from 100Hz up to 20 kHz. If the input and the output capacitors would be changed to bigger values, it could probably even go lower than 100Hz. If I go higher than 20 kHz, the signal starts to wobble, but this is made by the phone, not by the amplifier. The datasheet for the TDA2822M is missing the recommended component value table, which can be found in the most amplifier IC datasheets. In this table, the manufacturer presents what happens if a component's value is smaller or bigger than the recommended value. I decided to do these tests and share the results with you. First, the input part is tested. If the 470 nF input capacitor is changed to smaller value, the low frequency cutoff will be higher. And if it is changed to bigger value, the frequency response goes lower. But if the value is too high, it can pass through really low frequencies, which can even damage the amplifier. Changing the 10K ohm input biasing resistor to smaller value decreases the input impedance, and the bigger value increases the input impedance. These changes results with the change of volume and stability. The recommended 10K ohm resistor has the best results. Changing the 100 microfarad capacitors at the inverting inputs to smaller values like 22 microfarad results with higher output power. Measuring the output showed that the RMS voltage increased to 1.44 volts before clipping, which means around 0.25 watts of output. Changing it to bigger like 220 microfarad generates instability and noise. If it is shorted to the ground, the circuit is not working. At the output, if the 470 microfarad capacitor is changed to a smaller value, the frequency response changes. It won't allow low frequencies to pass. If it is changed to higher value, the frequency response at low frequencies will be better. The 100 nanofarad filter capacitor filters out high frequency noise and prevents oscillation. Putting a smaller value cap increases the high frequency bandwidth, but also there is a risk of oscillation. Placing a bigger cap results with more high frequency cutoff, but less noise and more stability. The 4.7 ohm resistor is not an indispensable component, but it can be used. Using smaller value or even leaving out this component from the circuit almost has no effect, but placing a higher value might not help to prevent the high frequency oscillation. I switched the ICs for the last time to see how they perform with the circuit, and the ST Microelectronics IC was the best. The second one was working, but it had more noise. The HYC label just did not work, something might have happened during testing. Lastly, here is a close-up shot of the circuit. The price of this IC ranges between 5 and 8 cents per piece, so it is really cheap. I do recommend this IC for learning, also it works with low supply voltage. It has low quiescent current, which is good for battery usage. Otherwise, it is an outdated, obsolete IC and there are better options. In this video, I did not use background music as a lot of you suggested, so let me know in the comments if it is better this way. Also, if you have any questions about this circuit, just ask in the comments. Also, consider donating a small amount of money, you can find the link in the description. The next video will be a Bluetooth speaker build, and after that, a dual variable voltage supply. Thank you for watching, leave a like if you want to see similar videos.